Today's reading is found in Luke chapter 23, verse 27 to 31. A great number of the people followed him, among them women who were mourning and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For this is certain, the days are coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, the wombs that never bore children, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For such things are done when the wood is green. What will happen when it's dry?" In some faith traditions, this scene is considered the ninth station of the cross. There are many historical renditions of the mourning women on the path towards Calvary. The women here are mourning the fact that their teacher, their rabbi, an innocent man, according to Jesus' followers, and even according to the Romans, is still being crucified because of the Jewish ruling class's judgment on him. To them, this is as bad as it can get. Everything is coming to a horrific, murderous end for their Savior, and they can't really do anything about it. To Jesus, this is just the beginning of a far worse persecution and judgment on his own Jewish people, the very people who he came not only to warn, but to save from this impending doom that was coming. You see, Jesus' language in this moment is as dark as it actually could be. He's telling these women that they shouldn't be mourning his death. What they should be mourning is something far worse. They should be far more concerned about what's coming for them and their families. In the Jewish tradition, offspring are the greatest blessings from the Lord. And so it was normative to say something like, "Blessed are those who give birth or who have children." But here Jesus is telling them that it's going to be so bad for Israel that the blessed will be the people who never had children and therefore do not have to watch their children suffer and die at the hands of the Romans. That's what he's saying is coming. It's terrifying. In this moment, Jesus sees clearly the impending judgment on Israel. And this is something that the Jewish ruling class did not know was coming. They didn't think it was coming. They didn't realize that their choices were actually going to produce this. And then there's Jesus using his foreknowledge to warn Israel as a prophet would that things are going to get much worse. And then you see the language of the green wood. He says the language of the green wood and the dry wood is kind of just that. He's comparing the perceived fire that he was under right now. He was comparing that to wet wood. He was saying what you think is the worst of the worst, this is just wet wood. This is nothing compared to the raging fire that's actually going to come for the Jewish people. And that's a fire with dry wood, which is like all-consuming, which lights quickly, which just explodes. That's kind of what he's saying is coming. That's the comparison there between the wet and the dry wood. And he's actually right about what comes within a generation. Jesus said these things would happen within a generation, and we know historically that he's actually right, just as he predicted it. If you're a history nut, just go look up the Jewish-Roman wars, and you will see what actually happened to the Jewish people within a generation of Jesus's life. And all this kind of climax in the destruction of the second temple in 70 AD, and the persecution actually continued on after that. It's really horrific stuff when you go and read it. It really is horrible stuff. When you think about Jesus telling them that you're going to be running to the hills in fear, that's what actually literally happened historically. And Jesus knew about this, and he warned his people about it. And those who listened to him, they had a chance to be spared. And those who died to themselves willingly, like Jesus told them to, they had a chance at literal new life, had an opportunity to be spared this great persecution. Those who took up their crosses in that moment, they wouldn't burn like the dry wood, like Jesus is talking about. Those who considered themselves the least of these willingly, they would be the greatest in the coming future judgment period. Those who ignored this message, however, would suffer inexplicably under the Romans over the next 50 years. And like we said, they did suffer. This is real historical stuff. They were too blind to see, because of their own self-righteousness, their attitudes of and rejection of the actual Messiah, Savior Jesus, who was sent by God to warn them about what was coming. And because of that, they actually suffered the very death that Jesus was coming to warn them about avoiding. It's a powerful, powerful consideration when you see it that way and you understand the teaching of Jesus in that light. Now, what we also know about Jesus' ministry is that we're often multiple meanings to a prophecy like this. Jesus did warn real people about real events that were going to happen, and we know, in fact, did happen just as Jesus predicted, but the warning doesn't stop there. Anything Jesus says, we know this, that it doesn't usually just refer to one particular moment in the future. You see, the warning of Jesus here that we read about the gospel in the Gospels is really a universal warning for all of us, and we see that throughout, particularly the New Testament scriptures. See, there is life and there's good life, there's salvation, there's protection, there's kingdom blessing, there's the promised land for those who trust in Jesus and surrender to his way of doing things. And then there's judgment for those who don't. And that was true for them, and it's also true for us today. You see, there's salvation for those who call upon Jesus as their king and as their savior, and there's destruction for those who don't. I personally experience life and life to the full when I surrender my life to Jesus today. And I personally experience judgment and death in my own life when I don't. It's historically true that those who trusted Jesus in the first century were able to live a good life, to live a meaningful life, to live a life of purpose and truth and love. We can read about it in the New Testament scriptures, all the descriptions of the church. That's the life that they lived, and it was good, and it was because of their faith in Jesus. And it's also true that those who didn't trust Jesus genuinely suffered for it. My encouragement to us today is to trust Jesus. He was right the first time, and we need to have faith that he's right about our lives today. And further than that, we need to surrender today for the sake of future generations. See, I don't want to look back and regret the life that I set up for my kids because of my lack of surrender. I do not want to be in a future where I even have the consideration that it would have been more blessed for me to not have children than to have the children I had because of the lack of surrender in my own life. It's a responsibility that I have for the kingdom of God and for my children. And so consider that aspect of surrender today.